nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Welcome back to our lecture on cells, the machine, focusing in on power consumption and power utilization of the cell. I'm Professor Rickus. In this lecture, we're going to be considering energy utilization and particularly the power output. What is the work that cells do and how much power does that require for those jobs of the cell? So one of the things that cells need to do often is to move, right? So cells will need to swim or migrate depending on the type of cell that they are and the environment they're in. So here's an example of actin-mediated migration of a cell. So here we see, and this process is done, it's an actin filament mediated process where these actin filaments are used to extend out a leading edge and extend out these phylopodia that move ahead of the cell and then sort of drags itself along. Okay, so we'll take a look at how much energy does this take for a cell to move some particular distance, right? It must do work to do this. Another example is cells contain molecular motors. This is another great machine, sort of mechanical analogy, and has been studied quite a bit because of this feature in the cell. So here's an example of a very well studied molecular motor, the ATP synthase. So by the name implies, we're actually generating ATP here from the conversion, in this case, from an electrochemical potential. But this protein complex actually physically moves and rotates. So it functions like a motor. It takes in power, rotates this, and part of its job is now converting electrochemical potential from a proton gradient into ATP via the movement, mediated by the movement of this motor. So let's look at some calculations that have been done now for this actin-driven motility to give us some sense of ballpark. So again, here's an example of a cell that's using this actin-driven movement by assembling these actin filaments, protruding them out and sort of dragging the cell along. And some calculations have been measured in these cells, such as the actin polymerization rate, as well as, and so we can sort of calculate this. We know that in this case, the cell was measured to move about 0.2 microns or 200 nanometers per second. And there's about 200 actin filaments here per micron in this leading edge that's extending out. So then these measured numbers can be used to calculate some power consumption for this cell to move. So if we take this actin polymerization rate and look at, we do some unit conversion here, and there's about 2 monomers per 5 nanometers of movement, and about 100 monomers now per second per filament is this polymerization rate. And if we look at the ATP requirement now, to go 20 microns, it takes about 200 filaments per micron and about 100 monomers per second per filament. And it's known that it takes about 1 ATP per monomer. So by using this now, we can calculate the ATPs per second, which is essentially our energy rate, right? Our power in ATPs per second. And using our estimate of about 50 to 70 kilojoules of free energy per mole in ATP. Now we can calculate the power consumption in watts of about 10 to the minus 14 watts, which is much smaller now than some of the other magnitudes that we looked at for this cell to move. So maybe smaller than you might have thought. You might have thought that it took a majority of the cell's energy to move, but the number's actually kind of small, and we'll look at bacteria here in a second and also compare it to its overall power consumption rate and start thinking about energy budgets. What percentage of the energy budget that the cell has to uses to do different types of work? So let's look at another form of cellular motility. So bacteria, for example, will often move or swim using flagella. So here's a cartoon now of our bacteria with these flagella coming off, and it uses this as these flagella, we've got this rotation. There's actually a motor here that facilitates this. So this protein-based system, this flagellar motor that rotates and moves these flagella so that the bacteria can swim along and can actually use this rotation to control direction as well, which is an interesting control and gene expression system that we'll look at later. But so here, let's look at some of the calculations that have been done. So again, some measurements that have been made on these flagellar motors, that they rotate somewhere around 100 hertz as a very common rotation rate, and that it takes about 1,000 protons to fuel this rotation. So now if they looked at the calculation of the protons needed, if we take this 1,000 protons per rotation per flagella and this rotation frequency for 4 flagella on this particular bacterial cell, and we get a calculation of a proton rate of about 4 times 10 to the 5th protons per second. So in the last case, we were using ATP as our major energy source for the movement. Here, the cell is using this proton motive force, this electrochemical potential that exists by creating proton gradients across a membrane and using that stored potential energy to drive the movement. So now here we're calculating our energy consumption rate, our power consumption rate in protons per second rather than ATP per second. And so under the condition of the cell, the proton motive force is about 150 millivolts. And so now we can convert this considering the energy per proton into joules or energy, and that comes out to about 10 to the minus 19 joules. Now to do the power consumption, or how much power expended by this movement, and we take this proton per second rate and convert this based on energy per proton, and we can get a power calculation again of about 10 to the minus 14 watts, very similar, same order of magnitude as our actin-based motility in our other cell. And so this, thinking about this per kilogram cell, is about 10 watts per kilogram cell. Now thinking about it in this unit, we can go back and we can consider the total power consumption of a bacteria being about 1,000 watts per kilogram. You can see that this motility for the swimming bacteria only takes, considering its total power budget, only about 1% of the total power consumption of the cell is needed to go towards swimming of this cell. Whereas you might have thought that that movement, that swimming, would consume a large part, but it's actually a small fraction, about 1%. So here's a case where some quantitative, even back of the envelope calculations, can help us build some intuition about the energy budget and the power consumption used by the cell to do different types of work and different jobs. So we can also think, we talked a bit about the storage in electrochemical potential across membranes, and cells use this quite regularly to move molecules around, particularly across membranes, both ions and small molecules. And these cellular pumps that create the electrochemical potential that can be used to do movement of these molecules have a nice analogy to pumps in pipe flow system, which you may be more familiar with if you've studied chemical or bioprocess engineering, for example. So if we think about a pump in a pipe flow, a pump's job is really to convert electrical energy into mechanical energy to move that fluid, and generates a pressure differential along our pipe, and that really drives flow through the pipe when a valve is open, right? So the fluid in this case will flow down this pressure differential when a valve is open. So if we think about now a molecular pump in molecular transport, here we've got the cell membrane now going this way, and we've got on top in purplish blue here a pump. And the job of this molecular pump converts chemical energy, often ATP, to create an electrochemical potential by pumping charged molecules such as sodium or potassium or protons, as we saw in our last example, to create and store an electrochemical potential across that membrane, which can then be used to drive ion movement across the cell membrane, right? So this electrochemical gradient can drive ion movement across the membrane when an ion channel is open. So the other ion channel acts like our valve, and this pump is converting this chemical energy into electrochemical potential that can be used to move ions or molecules. So in this way, by looking at these analogies, I think it will help facilitate and perhaps change your view on the biology or biochemistry that you may have learned, to see them through an engineering lens a bit, in which when we're engineering traditional mechanical and electrical machines, to think about power consumption is very immediate and obvious. We're sort of trained to do that. But we don't always think that way immediately when we're thinking about engineering cells, but perhaps we should. And so from this sense, I think it's kind of fun to even think about, really, when you think about life or at least death, we can sort of think of a thermodynamic definition of death. Right, so cells operate far from equilibrium, and equilibrium conditions really equal death. Cell death occurs when this minimal activity, so again, think about this minimal function of taking in energy as molecular food, converting it into storable or usable energy such as ATP, ATP that's used to do cellular work, making more cells as the most fundamental job that it needs to do, which primarily consists of making big biomolecules, right? And that self-assemble into other cells. And these generally are reactions that require work, require energy to make them happen, as well as creating other forms of storable and usable potential, such as electrochemical potential, that can also be used to do cellular work and to convert back into ATP that's usable. So cell death really occurs when this minimal activity breaks down. And you see, we're really talking about energy here, taking in energy, converting it, and doing work. That's really what cells are doing. And cells die when this minimal activity breaks down. So when a cell stops taking in energy and doing work, it falls to an equilibrium state, which is death. So from this sense, at least cell death has a very thermodynamic viewpoint. Now, life is a much more difficult thing to define, but death, at least, the absence of life, is fairly easy to define from a thermodynamic point of view. And so one of the take-home messages here is that life, while seemingly complex, special and different from non-living things, this is one of the things that makes it so difficult to form a definition of life, the physical form of organisms from bacteria to humans still follows the law of physics, right? And so therefore cells are subject to the tools and approaches of engineering design. And this is one of the major take-home lessons that I want you to take away from the first couple lectures that we've been going through. So a remaining challenge is really to develop more tools for measuring and accounting for the complete energy budget of the cell and looking at the complete energy balance of the cell. And this may become very important as we begin to increase more sophisticated and complex cellular devices, including bioreactors and biofuel cells. As we engineer new work for the cell to do, we need to understand the constraints of how that fits into the overall energy budget of the cell. And are there ways then, as we do with many machines, such as our cars, can we engineer to improve efficiency toward the job that we want the cells to do? So these are lots of things to think about as you're thinking about cellular design and moving forward into the future. And a couple of sources, some of which we've pulled for this lecture, both Cell Biology by the Numbers and Physical Biology of the Cell, are great sources for further reading. Some of this is available online as well as in the books. And coming up now, we will think of the cell as sort of a different type of machine and start to look at its function as a sensor. And we will look at a photoreceptor as a case study of a cellular sensor, and particularly use this to extract and examine some of the design principles at the molecular and microarchitecture level of the cell that give the photoreceptor really amazing sensing performance, things such as being able to function as a single photon detector in the dark. So I hope to see you next time.